Hello students, today we are going to discuss the major difference between current account and capital account. So what is this capital account and current account and why this is such a mess in a student's mind? Let's discuss it in a very simplified steps so that you can grab your attention to it. So starting with current account. This mainly captures the transactions when it takes place in goods, in terms of goods and services. So, number one point would be under current account is that it is transactions and services. Okay, so here it includes different types of goods and services that are produced in a country and of course abroad as well. Now from here, the term that I said is abroad. So this means what? That under this capital account, there is involvement of exports and imports. Okay, so talking about exports and imports over here, we can find that this current account, it is mainly determined and dependent on how the net exports changes. So, net exports, I'm going to write it as NX. So, what is net exports? Export minus import. So, X stands for export and M stands for imports. So here net export is the main determinant for this current account, right? Now this export thing, so export is a function of here Y star and competitiveness. This is a very interesting thing that we are going to focus on now. And import, which is again a function of Y and competitiveness. So what is this Y and Y star? Y is the domestic income and Y star is the international income. Now talking about this competitiveness, what is this competitiveness and how it is determined? Well, talking about competitiveness, it is mainly expressed in terms of relative prices. So competitiveness is determined by the relative prices. Which is, what is the relative price now? Price of the own country's product to the foreign country's product. So that relative price determines this competitiveness. And this competitiveness further determines the export and import. And this export and import further determines the net export of a country. And from net exports, we can get a hands-on current account. Now, so I hope the competitiveness part is clear. Now let's see how competitiveness affects the export. Or X, we can write. If competitiveness is increasing, then we can say that export of a country is increasing rather than import. So competitiveness and export are positively or directly proportional to each other, right? If competitiveness increases, that implies that export increases and import falls. So under this situation, if the competitiveness of the world increases, then what is the situation over here? We can ultimately find that the net exports is increasing. And if the net exports is increasing, then the current account, this is increasing, isn't it? As current account is directly determined from the net exports. right? And vice versa also, if competitiveness reduces, then we can find that export is reducing whereas imports is reducing, and ultimately we can find that net exports falls. So here the final thing, net exports increases, this implies that, let's write current account as CA, so this increases and here CA falls. Okay, now here we are talking about competitiveness, and competitiveness, as I said, is dependent on the relative prices, right? So this determined by relative prices. And now if you can recall that from relative prices, another important topic, an important concept comes in, that is the exchange rate. Exactly. So the relative prices is nothing but P by P star, where P is our domestic income and P star is our international income or world market price. So this gives rise to another term known as the exchange rate. So now ultimately what we can say, the current account, which is determined by national net exports, which is determined by export and import, the subtraction of the two. Now these depend upon the competitiveness. Competitiveness is determined by the relative prices, and from relative prices we can find the exchange rate. Now, so ultimately what we can say, that current account is dependent upon this exchange rate in order to be determined. So how the exchange rate is changing, from there we can get an idea of our current account that is prevailing in a particular country. Okay, so this is a brief description in a very short and compact and crisp form. You're getting the important facts of current account. Now move to capital account and its importance, followed by its constituents as well, and how it is being determined. Okay, so next one, capital account. See, what do we get here by listening to this capital? What just comes into our mind? Machineries, plants. So we can constrain our capital knowledge to the flexible capital and the fixed capital. What is flexible now? That means the plants and machineries which can be transferred, that means which are mobile in nature, so that is known as the flexible capital. And what is fixed capital? That means the plants and industries which cannot be moved from one particular place to the other. Alright? Okay, coming back to this capital account. So capital account, by just hearing it, we can grab the concept that, okay, so it's something related to this capital. So this is not exactly capital that we mean, rather it involves the transactions of financial assets. So earlier it was the transactions of goods and services, here it is the transactions of only financial assets. So note down the first point, is that it is transactions of financial assets. Now if you want to know some examples of financial assets, it can be in the form of bond, then it can be in terms of securities. So securities are again, it can be like government securities or many other mutual funds. Okay, so these all are nothing but the financial assets. Now, so when talking about this financial asset, what is the investor keeping in mind before investing? how the interest rate is changing or how the interest rate is prevailing in a particular economy. From there, we are getting the concept of financial asset and the investing on financial assets, right? So here the important term that we need to ponder on is interest rate. I'm going to denote it by small r. Okay, so how this interest rate is changing, that is affecting the decisions of the investors. Talking about investors, so investor will always prefer any country with the higher interest rate rather than being the lower one, isn't it? So if R is greater than R star, here R star is what? This is the world interest rate and R is our domestic interest rate. Let's just denote it. So small r is domestic interest rate and R star is our international interest rate. Okay, so if this is the case where R is greater than R star, that means domestic rate of interest is higher than the world rate of interest, then what will happen? The investors will definitely come to our country for investing because here they are going to get a higher rate of interest. So here will be capital inflow because the investors will be investing more due to higher rate of interest. Similarly, if we have the opposite situation where R is less than R star, so here the investors will not be investing in our country, they will be preferring other countries or any foreign countries where the rate of interest is higher. So ultimately what will happen? Capital outflow. This means what? Outflow, talking about outflow. Even the domestic investors will not be interested in investing in our country because the world rate of interest is higher than the country's rate of interest. So that is why even the domestic investors will prefer outside or foreign countries. Okay, so this will ultimately lead to capital outflow. And if capital outflow is going on, that means what? That the capital account is depreciating. It is reducing. So from this discussion till now, we can find that the capital account equilibrium is existing where this R and R star are equal to each other. Equilibrium of capital account is existing where R is equal to R star. Only then we are going to have this situation. Right? And listen, as I have said, that when talking about this outflow, even our domestic investors are trying to invest in the foreign countries' bonds or securities. So this means what? That it has been pre-assumed that there is the capital are perfectly similar. That means perfect substitutes of each other. That means in terms of basic characteristics like risk, time to maturity and return. So these things are completely similar. Then only this condition is going to prevail. That is, the domestic investors are also ready to invest in the foreign countries' bonds and securities and other financial assets. Same goes for this country, this condition as well, where capital inflow is taking place. So this means that the being capital are perfect substitutes in both the countries. So the foreign investors are like irrelevant and foreign investors are completely not being on a discriminable position whether to invest or not, because they are just seeing this return. And being the capital substitutes, they can easily invest in our country as well, or in the domestic country. Now, what will happen if the capitals are not perfect substitutes? Because that is generally the situation where the capitals are not always perfect substitutes of each other, right? So under that situation, we can find that this outflow thing, if we consider this second position, then we can find that being imperfect capital, the domestic producers or domestic investors will not be willing to invest in foreign countries' assets. Okay? Because according to them, the asset that they are holding and the asset that the foreign countries are holding are completely different, and that is why it may be a high chance that they will be they are frauded. Okay, so that is why our domestic investors will not be willing to invest in foreign countries' assets, which is generally the situation, because while investing we go through generally a various types of statistics that whether the investing will actually get us any benefits or not. Okay, so now this is the basic equilibrium that we are talking about. And so ultimately, from these two conditions, okay, what we can find? Change in capital stock is actually function of the difference between the interest rate of the two countries. Right? So this is again a very important condition that you need to remember while distinguishing this capital account and current account. Right? So this is the thing, that change in the capital stock is a function of the difference between the rate of interest of a particular country and the world rate of interest. So when talking about capital account, we need to focus on the rate of interest, whereas in talking about the current account, we needed to focus on the exchange rate. So these are the two basic and important distinction between these two. And another important thing under this capital account is that if we have higher capital mobility, that means the mobility of capital is very much volatile or flexible, in terms that any amount of capital can flow from other country to this country, to the domestic country. Then what will happen? Under higher capital mobility, so we have a situation where R will be very much close to R star. That means it will tend to this equilibrium position, right? Because we are talking about higher capital mobility. And this in the BOP, we can find that under high capital mobility or perfect capital mobility, the BOP line, that is the balance of payment line, is completely horizontal to the x-axis. So this implies that the equality between R and R star. And finally, coming to this, if there is surplus in capital account, that means when the capital is inflowing, I just rub that part, erase that part. So if the capital is inflowing, then we have a situation where there is surplus in the capital account, right? So if there is surplus in capital account, that will be compensated by a deficit in the current account, because there is an equality that is being maintained when talking about BOP, balance of payment. We need to consider, okay, I can write it as KA, and earlier the current account was denoted as CA. So CA plus of KA, and that is equal to zero. Then we can say that balance of payment is balanced, right? That means what? This identity will hold. That means summation or the current account and capital account of a country will always be equalized to each other. So this means if there is capital account is higher than the current account. So this means what? There is surplus in capital account and there is deficit in current account. Surplus in capital account and along with that deficit in current account. Okay, and the opposite also holds. If this is the situation where the current account is greater than the capital account, then we have surplus in current account and deficit in capital account. Okay, so this is how the balance of payment is maintained throughout. And that's all about the discussion of current and capital account, its basic differences and ways to remember. Thank you, and if you have any kind of doubts, please let us know. Thank you.